to Chair Dr. D.C. Kadoji, Co-Chair, my best friend, my beloved Dr. Nathan Nair, my co-speakers Dr. Tanuja Misri, Dr. Jayanda Modern, Dr. Praveen, my nephew, Dr. Prashant, dear dignitaries of the dais, a warm good evening to all of you. First of all, let me tell you that now, these two, we have heard that two interventions, but I am telling about an invention. That is regarding a medicine called Zingivir H tablets. This is a study report on a randomized, single-blind, placebo-controlled, multi-center clinical trial. Is it visible?
Yes, sir. It is visible and audible.
Okay.
Dr. Nair is visible, but not his presentation.
It is not visible. So what you do? Let me. Now, am I visible? No.
Okay.
Regarding Zingivir H tablets, the journey starts from here. During 2019, and November 2019, when we heard about the first incident of COVID-19 in Wuhan, we were looking at each other and we were on the belief that, okay, let the allopaths decide and let the allopaths invent as Nipah or other diseases, let them do. Again, we were waiting for the next news to come. And 24th of December 2019, we heard that first death from Wuhan because of the COVID-19. Again, on the second week of February, WHO held the second meeting on the protocol development of COVID-19 management. After reading the minutes of that meeting, I thought of developing something from our system. Actually, those days, everybody was skeptical about the disease. We are afraid of the symptoms, and the news were spreading were very negative. We had been using a formula for viral fever acute bronchitis, and based on that, I have managed to develop one product and hand it over to our R&D department. Our R&D is headed by Dr. Shyam Sashidharan, a clinical pharmacologist, having nearly 20 scientists, 20 doctors in his team, nearly 16 Ayurvedic doctors there. And they managed to prepare the monograph and have conducted the pilot study and would get the license by April 2020. Then simultaneously, we went to Rajiv Gandhi Center for Biotechnology, CSIR, Papanagoda for the cell line human study, and as well as we started animal study. After that, we went to 5 medical colleges of the country, not from Kerala. So outside Kerala, 5 medical colleges I have approached through a clinical research organization. And I could succeed in getting the ethical committee approval from those medical colleges and registered with the CTRI on 28th of April 2020. And after that, immediately we could start the clinical trial on 3rd May 2020. With a protocol called ICH-GCP protocol. This is internationally accepted, WHO accepted protocol. Then only we can claim this trial among the developed countries. The study was randomized, single-blind, placebo-controlled, multi-center add-on therapy clinical trial in 116 COVID-19 positive patients having mild to moderate symptoms. Trial completed by July 3rd week. Initially, it was a very painful journey. Still, by the grace of Bhagavan, Dhanvantari, we could finish the trial by July 3rd week. And the interim data of 42 patients were submitted to Ayush Government of India on 8th July. The intention was, while getting these data, nearly one third of the data to be submitted to the authorities before publishing to the media. So for getting permission from Ayush department for press meet only, I have submitted the 42 patients the list on 8th of July. And the final report of 116 patients were submitted on 24th of July. 24th of July, the entire report has been submitted to Ayush Government of India. And after getting that report, a DMC having 5 members, headed by Dr. V. Ramankutty, the renowned epidemiologist, has been formed, and the committee has peer-reviewed the study reports and found it as highly significant in COVID-19. These are the committee members: Dr. V. Ramankutty, epidemiologist and data science consultant; Dr. K.P. Paulos, again former professor, Kottayam Medical College; Dr. K.G. Devendran, an Ayurvedic doctor, retired medical director, Ayurvedic Pharmacy, Coimbatore; then Dr. Asha Kamath, statistician, professor and head of the Department of Data Science at PSPH, Mangalore; Dr. V.S. Sugunan, former scientist, C, group leader, viral hepatitis lab, Rajiv Gandhi Center for Biotechnology, Trivandrum. These 5-member committee peer-reviewed the study report, and based on that, with their report only, we have submitted all these to Government of India, Ayush Department. Now for the newcomers about the research, how we are conducting the study in modern medicine and Ayurveda. We have been hearing a lot of stories like phase 4, phase 3 studies are completed. We are waiting for the phase 5, like for the last 1 year in the case of vaccinations. The phase 1 and 2, that means investigative new drug processing. That is IND processing. And after IND processing, we are developing the modern medicine. They are identifying, they are developing a molecule, and then application to healthy individuals for registration, 10 to 20 individual samples to be, subjects to be taken. After trying in 20 healthy individuals, only we could get the registration. Then new drug application. New drug application means 100 subjects to be tried. That is multi-center trial for getting approval. After that only, the phase 4 study, that means multi-center trials, maximum 10,000 samples, different status of life, different economics, different educational, etc., to evaluate efficacy and rule out long-term side effects. And all these, we have been hearing the study of vaccines, the phase 4 completed, reaching the phase 5, like phase 5 means PMS, post-marketing survey. This is regarding modern medicine. When it comes to Ayurvedic drug development, first of all, the R&D needs to be identified, the demand, the potential, the safety and efficacy, what are the things to be done through R&D? That role to be identified first, that is the phase 1. Phase 2 means review of literature from primary, secondary and tertiary sources. Primary means the identified literatures, identified journals or books, regulatory authority approved journals like API, that is called primary literature. Secondary literature means identified manuscripts, textbooks, monograph of other publications, like all these coming under the secondary literature. Tertiary literature means newspapers, social media publications, then science websites, those are all coming under the tertiary literature. The third one, pre-formulation of drug based on chemical and spectral analysis. This is for new development, not for the existing formula. This is just for modern new Ayurvedic drug development, modern Ayurvedic development. Then the fourth one, efficacy and safety of raw materials and then to formula. Then fifth one, standardization, physical, chemical and biological evaluations. Then the accelerator stability study, shelf life study, then pharmacological evaluations, and then to the monograph preparation. After the monograph preparations, then protocols to be developed. Protocols to be based on the traditional methods as well as the good clinical practice method, both to be inculcation of both together. Then only the modern society, WHO like agencies, should accept. Otherwise, after completion of the study, when you go to the regulatory authorities, they will reject. Though, so the protocols to be, while preparing the protocol, that should be very keen in inculcating both GCP and traditional methods together. Then the clinical trial with the standard procedure and due approval of regulatory authorities. In the case of Ayurvedic, in modern medicine, phase 4 means 10,000 patients to be tried. Phase 3 means for getting registration, 100 patients to be tried. And that is here. Clinical trial means if you are using non-ingredients which are prescribed in manuscripts, only 100 to 120 subjects needed, and that will be accepted. If you are using a formulating a polyherbal formulation without non-ingredients, without the existing ingredients, if you are using a new ingredient, all these, all the other protocols to be fulfilled. And then eight, publication of IPR registration. This is for the knowledge of the new generation Ayurvedic doctors to how to proceed with a clinical trial. This is about Singivirax tablets, a poly herbo mineral tablet having 7 natural ingredients described, they're all described in our manuscripts. Lavanga, Ardraga, Musta, Parpadaga, Ajamoda, Hingula, mercuric sulfide, and Haridala, arsenic trisulfide. In this preparation, each 500 milligram tablet contains 20 milligram Hingulam and 10 milligram Haridalam. Lavanga, Eugenia caryophyllus. Eugenol is the major active compound. Eugenol induces glutathione. Glutathione is very much required for inhibition of this proteases, which in turn cause viral replication. And eugenol has got antipyretic and adaptogenic property. Adaptogenic property medicines are required. We are describing about the cytokine storm here. When the patient develops cytokine storm, naturally the mental status of the patient will be altered and he will become mad-like, and so many suicidal attempts or suicides happened in Kerala. And because of that, while preparing a medicine, adaptogenic ingredients also to be added. Ardraga. Ginger oils are the main effective principles having effect in RS. Respiratory syncytial virus. While preparing the formulation, I have been very keen in using ingredients which are having antiviral properties. A respiratory syncytial virus is an RNA virus which is similar to that of COVID, SARS-CoV-2 virus. It inhibits inflammation and viral replication. Inhibits viral spreading. First of all, the viral replication is inhibiting, then the viral spreading is inhibiting. Then stimulate epithelial cells to secrete interferon alpha. Interferon alpha is very much required to curtail these proteases, to control the proteases for supporting viral progeny. Then adaptogenic, antipyretic, and immunomodulator. Then Musta. Everybody knows the potent antiviral drug proven effective in herpes simplex virus. Here also HSV virus. So Musta has got antiviral property, means that Musta has got effect on COVID-19 virus as well. That is the thinking process what we accept, what we incorporated while preparing the formulation. And studies, peer-reviewed journals, from the peer-reviewed journals, I could see that antipyretic efficacy of the Musta is proven in comparison with acetyl salicylic, that is aspirin. Then Parpadaga, Phidiotis corymbosa, a non-ingredient in Ayurvedic manuscripts as a potent antipyretic agent. It has got adaptogenic property as well as immunomodulatory property. Then Ayamodaga, hepatoprotective, antimicrobial, digestive stimulant, bronchodilator, anti-inflammatory and gastroprotective. In viral attacks, naturally the virus, first of all, the virus will enter into the liver. So liver protective medicines are required. Then antimicrobial, naturally. Then digestive stimulants. Digestive stimulants are required. The gastrointestinal mucosa will be affected. Then anti-inflammatory. Of course, the viral infection will directly enter into the lungs and the endothelium, the inside the mucous membrane, inside the lungs will be affected. So anti-inflammatory drugs are very much required. The second meeting of WHO held during February 2020, concept put forward in controlling COVID was adding anti-inflammatory drug along with the prevailing system. Then gastroprotective, Hingulam mercuric sulfide. See, now everybody is skeptical about heavy metal preparations, but I should say heavy metals are very much required, and the skepticism towards heavy metals to be, this is the first step from my side. Then the R&B, PG holders as well as the new generation Ayurvedic doctors should think of this. This is a high time to think positively towards using mercuric compounds or arsenic compounds or heavy metals along with the metallic herbal preparations. Here again, mercuric sulfide has got antiviral effect in viruses like avian influenza virus, atypical pneumonia, measles virus, mumps virus, respiratory syncytial virus, adenovirus, rubella virus, polio virus, hepatitis A, B, C, D, E, and G, and then herpes simplex virus. Here, why I am showing all this peer reviewed journal says that mercuric sulfide has got potent antiviral effect. The devastating effect of Ringulam helps to inactivate the proteases where the virus cannot replicate. If the proteases are given free hand, they will support viruses to replicate, where viral progeny will be produced and the system will be damaged within a short span of nearly 6 to 12 hours. So the mercuric compound, when reaches the effective concentration, can inhibit all proteases in the whole process of viral replication. That is very important to understand, and inactivate these proteases so that all viruses invading the human body can be checked. As long as the reasonable dosage is consumed, body will not be poisoned and the viruses invaded in human body can be killed. The reasonable dosage to be consumed, though 200 to 300 milligram per day can be used. I have added only 20 milligram. That again, 6 tablets per day is using as therapeutic dosage. 120 milligram is consumed. That is enough for a better result. 200 to 300 milligram per day is the permissible dosage of mercuric sulfide. Then comes hydrodala, arsenic trisulfide. It's a potent antiviral agent. It's a bronchial tonic. It's an expectorant. Inhibits HCV replication. Here also, the antiviral property of arsenic trisulfide helps in the production of interferon alpha. Interferon alpha is very much required to inhibit the production of the multiplication of viruses and the spreading of viruses. But interferon alpha is working on the proteases where the proteases will be damaged and the further replication can be arrested. This is a very important slide, metals and immunity. This to be propagated well among the modern society. The modern society is totally against Ayurveda, saying that all Ayurvedic drugs are containing heavy metals and the contaminations are there, even willfully adding heavy metals like, but heavy metals are safe. This is this for the information of the newcomers, these slides. Metals are required for maintaining the metabolic equilibrium of our body. Even metallic equilibrium itself giving immunity to our system. Metals from outside are added and processed with the herbal plants to give herbometallic drugs. The herbometallic interactions like mercury and arsenic are believed to assist the delivery of the drugs to the target, so that when the target is activated, when the medicine reaches the target, that will contribute maximum therapeutic effect and is safe as well. This is very important, cytokine storm. What is cytokine storm? See, most of the cases noticed here and the death rate increased because of viral pneumonia and the damage of the alveolar destruction is happening. When a virus attacks our body, lymphocytes, macrophages, etc. will be secreted in larger quantity. And simultaneously, interleukin, cytokine like weapons also will be produced in larger quantity in our body, which in turn cause apoptosis or alveolar destruction and cause death. The second day, third day, the normal range of cytokine will be between 200 to 500. The second day, third day, it will cross more than 30,000 and come back to 10,000 or 15,000. It will not come back to 200 or 500 like that. But in cytokine storm, when we use our medicine, Zingivirax, the increase, the cytokine will come down drastically to 5,000 or 3,000. And the alveolar destruction will be arrested and the patient can be saved. The pentavalent hydrodala will considerably control the production of interleukin and cytokine, and thus inflammatory cell infiltration in the lungs can be reversed. When there is an inflammatory cell infiltration inside the lungs, the alveolar destruction will happen and pneumonia, end result is pneumonia, and even without oxygen, nobody can survive. Acute respiratory distress syndrome can be prevented, then ventilation not required and can save the life. This is cytokine storm. How the medicine prevent cytokines from this. So just for your information. So next 3-4 slides I am going to read out for the knowledge, for the awareness, for the awareness of the newcomer Ayurvedic doctors, or new generation doctors, or the PG holders, scholars, just to have a look on how this heavy metal supporting our system. Evidence by experiments in removing the toxicity of heavy metals. I'm only a graduate, but I am advocating for R&B doctors here. We have conducted the chemical characterization of gingivirus and its raw materials, especially heavy metals, through X-ray diffraction studies and LCMS at CSIR NIIST. It's a central government organization. The study was mainly conducted to know whether on traditional purification of heavy metals result in the structural or chemical change or not. The results from the studies clearly showed that there are some addition reactions happening at the raw materials, especially heavy metals, during the traditional Ayurvedic purification process, which resulted in the addition of several function groups like CO and neutral groups. This is very important. X-ray photo electron spectroscopy, XPS, analysis reveals the increase in carbon atoms from 7.94 weight percentage to 51.70 weight percentage, revealing that the gingivirus is added with several organic molecules and compounds. The density of arsenic compound is changed from the raw materials to finished products, and this resulted in the change of the valency, that is trivalency to pentavalency. Arsenic trisulfide, the inorganic form, is in trivalent form. After the purification process, after the final, then the end product, when we analyze it, it is having the pentavalent form, that is 100% organic. This change in the valency will considerably reduce the toxicity of arsenic compound to negligible level. Mercury becoming organic in nature, and the density of the mercury reduces to 1.60% from 72.03%, shows the detoxification and purification. This is very, very, very important for R&B students. Mercury becoming organic in nature, and the density of the mercury reduces to 1.6% from 72.03%, which shows the detoxification and purification. In the final product, the percentage of sulfur reduced to 2.85% from 13.92%. Again, one more important point. This result indicates that during purification, the concentration of sulfur reduces, and this sulfur is utilized for purifying the heavy metal. That is very important. Thus, the XPS studies reveal the chemical changes, detoxification and purification reaction of the heavy metal salts in the preparation. This to be there always in your mind while propagating the heavy metal metallic preparations before the scientific forums. Everybody knows about the result of heavy metals and its compositions, or the polyherbal with the mineral, polyherbo mineral combinations. But nobody is advocating for these products or heavy metallic combinations with these scientific backgrounds. So first of all, I am bringing this new idea towards the R&B students. You should propagate this. You should have studies like this. And we have every facilities in CSIR, Papanangoda, Trivandrum, and other CSIR centers, so that the new R&B students should go there to have to enjoy the facilities, to conduct studies there, and you can present this before the scientific forums to convince them about the safety of these polyherbal mineral combinations. Through LCMS-MS analysis, we found higher concentration of antioxidant-rich glutathione, and this glutathione is also used for detoxification processes. The combination contains clove, which contains glutathione. That glutathione in turn supporting along with antioxidants, and this glutathione is also used for detoxification of the raw materials. Thus, the traditional purification process will convert toxic nature of inorganic heavy metals to considerably less toxic or non-toxic organic form in the final product. Therefore, the ancient Ayurvedic technique for the heavy metal purification was not random, but had scientific reasons. Ayurvedic thinkers might have adopted a rigorous trial and error method to produce medicinally active, higher, pure, highly pure heavy metals. He studies in cell line studies, that's heart cells studies, myocardium cell line studies. The preliminary cytotoxicity testing of syngeneous tablets against normal cell lines was conducted at CSIR NIST Thiruvananthapuram. From the result, it was very clear that the syngeneous tablets, its raw materials and intermediate are non-toxic to the cell lines tested, and it does not inhibit the cell growth and morphology. It's a very valid point. So from the result, it is clear that syngeneous tablet is safe for human cells as it is non-toxic towards normal cell line tested. Then coming back to syngeneous. As I said earlier, it contains 7 known ingredients, and the synergy and the peculiar combination helps to control the spread of SARS-CoV-2 pandemic. Though all the ingredients are commonly used in our daily clinical practice, we have been using all these ingredients in our clinical practice for so many decades. Everybody knows about all these ingredients. But the synergy and the peculiarity of this combination make this preparation a unique one. It is in tablet form. The therapeutic dosage is 500 milligram tablets every third hourly for 10 to 15 days. 6 a.m., 9 a.m., 12 p.m., 3 p.m., 6 p.m., 9 p.m., like that. Children between 3 and 5 years have the dosage, 5 to 10 years, one tablet 4 times daily. And this has got prophylactic effect as well. Antiviral medicines are there inside our body. The proteases cannot activate, and proteases will be inhibited, and the proteases cannot support the viral progeny to spread, and the virus cannot be, further developed. And dosage is after 10 years of age, one tablet 3 times daily for 10 to 15 days, then 15 days gap again, 10 days. Like, I have been using this formula in and around my place, my village, and for the last so many months, and I have saved more than thousands of people. Everybody knows here in our place, and it has got very antiviral property as well as the prophylactic property. Children 5 to 10 years, one tablet 2 times daily, then 3 to 5 years, half tablet 2 times daily for 10 to 15 days, or as directed by the physician. And this is regarding our clinical trial. It's a randomized, placebo-controlled, single-blind, multi-center trial as add-on therapy conducted after registering with the Clinical Trial Registry of India. I have conducted one more study, that is randomized, placebo-controlled, double-blind, multi-center trial. It's a standalone therapy with syngeneous alone. After getting approval, only I'm bringing the second study. Initially, 5 medical colleges were selected and started the trial. Modern medical colleges, not Ayurveda medical colleges. 5 medical colleges were selected and started the trial from first week of May 2020. Study has been completed with 116 subjects. I've had 58 drug arm and 58 placebos. Drug arm, all 58 patients, RT-PCR became negative on 5th day. Not a joke. On 5th day, on an average, and placebo on 8th day, with highly significant p-value 0.05. The primary endpoint analysis elaborately assessed the clinical recovery time in detail between the treatment groups and the placebo groups. Log rank test is performed to verify the significance of recovery time over syngeneous and placebo, and it was resulted with a p-value 0.05. and lead to the conclusion that syngeneous use was associated with a difference in time to clinical improvements in less than 5 days compared to placebo group, which has recovery time up to 13 days. Laboratory samples were assessed for the patients before the start of the drug on day 1, day 6, day 15, and end of the treatment day, and then day 30 for safety analysis. The safety outcomes. Safety outcomes included adverse events that occurred during treatment, serious adverse events, and the premature discontinuation of the treatment. This is the protocol. The ICH-DCP standard protocol says these are to be observed. In the present study, no adverse events, serious adverse events, or adverse drug reaction are reported in the treated patients. The analysis of important hematological parameters, including CRP, ESR, IL-6, IgG, IgM, etc., revealed the potential immunomodulatory role of syngeneous tablets. The conclusion. The trial reveals that syngeneous treatment has significantly accelerated clinical improvement in COVID-19 patients and reduced mortality without any adverse side effects. This is the conclusion. And for your information, I hope, though I couldn't see you, all of you, I think you might have heard all these slides from my side. And this study is a wonderful study. I have submitted all these documents to Ayush Government of India on 24th of July. And some queries they have raised, and all this are being answered, and still waiting for the approval from Ayush to come. Actually, when we have the drug license, the indications were viral fever and acute viral bronchitis. We have submitted our request to the Ayush to repurpose the indication. That means to repurpose as COVID-19. But so far we didn't receive anything. That is the irony. I don't know what happened to Ayush. Anyway, I'm hopeful. I'm always positive. I'm eagerly waiting for their response to come. And without much delay, it will be all these study reports will be published in peer-reviewed journals, international journals. And once it is published, that is as good as approval from Government of India. That is my submission. And with these words, I conclude my paper here. And once again, I congratulate the entire team behind Global Ayurveda Festival. And I extend my sincere gratitude to all of you for giving me such a wonderful occasion to present my views here. Thank you. Thank you, Chair and Co-Chair.